We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
In September of 1962, the United States President John F. Kennedy officially announced the initiation of the Apollo space program, the task of which was to land a man on the moon by the end of the decade. This announcement was the beginning of transformation of a small industry into something epic. And within the framework of this epic program, both the legendary rocket and the no less legendary assembly site for it were created. And while the Apollo has already become a part of history, its place of birth continues to rise above the shores of the Atlantic, preparing to return a human to the moon. We are headed to Cape Canaveral to discover the greatest garage in human history. By the time of Kennedy's famous speech, Canaveral was already the main launch site for the United States. Since the end of the 1940s, the V-2 missiles brought from defeated Germany have been tested on the Cape, and later it was from here that rockets flew, allowing the first devices and people to touch the space. Now it was time to touch the moon. Apollo was an incredibly large-scale program that was striking in its ambitions. Moreover, it was not only about the space technology itself, rockets and spacecraft, but also about the infrastructure hidden in their shadow. While at the end of the 1940s, the V-2, with a mass of 12.5 tons and a height of 14 meters, was launched from the test site in Florida, now the spaceport was supposed to provide the launch of Saturn V, a monster weighing 2,970 tons, with a height of 110 meters. To jump high, you need to stand firmly on your feet. And while the rocket scientists were creating an incredible launch vehicle, their colleagues were creating a space center for it. And their work was equally important. It was impossible to solve this task by simple scaling. The main problem with the size and complexity of the new rockets was assembly and flight preparation. Previously, most of the preparation, testing and fine-tuning of rockets was carried out right at the launch site, which was quite long and difficult, plus required the delivery of a very large amount of equipment here. This is not counting the harmful effects of the environment. The rockets stood under the sun and rain all day, which did not help it at all. It would be incredibly difficult and frankly dangerous to prepare Saturn V for launch this way. Therefore, a new concept was developed, which assumed that most of the work, from assembly to testing, would be performed indoors with infrastructure available on site, and the finished rocket was to be delivered to a nearby launch pad. It was decided to build the entire complex on Merritt Island. This is how Launch Complex 39 was born. And then the most difficult task arose, the creation of a covered area for all these works. The features of the rocket dictated their own terms. Firstly, the Saturn V was too big to be brought ready-made from some factory, especially considering that it was made at several factories at once. Secondly, the rocket was so large that assembling it horizontally and then lifting it vertically could damage it. Therefore, the assembly had to be carried out vertically, as if they were constructing a high-rise building. This solution has many advantages, but there is also a problem. The assembly site is not very large in terms of the area of foundation, but is very high. A 110 meter rocket, which by the way is tens of meters higher than the Statue of Liberty, should easily fit into it, and this is not even including spaces for cranes, equipment and roof structures. The task for engineers and architects was in fact to build a skyscraper, inside which skyscrapers would be built. At the same time, it was necessary to take into account the features of the region. The gigantic structure had to not only stand in its place, but also withstand external influences, soil displacements, humidity, and hurricanes that are not uncommon here. This skyscraper for skyscrapers was the Vertical Assembly Building, or simply VAB. A little later, it was renamed Vehicle Assembly Building, but the meaning didn't change. Construction of the giant facility began in 1963. To support such a huge structure, 4,225 piles were driven into the ground, and 23,000 cubic meters of concrete were poured. Most of the above-ground structure, however, is not made of stone, but of metal. The assembly of the structure took 89,500 tons of steel. But despite the scale, the construction was completed just 3 years after the start, in 1966. The result of the construction is impressive. Above the green fields of the Space Center rises a structure 160 meters high, 280 meters long, and 157 meters wide. And this is not an ordinary tower like the usual skyscrapers. This is in fact a hangar with a volume of 3,665,000 cubic meters. This is the total volume of almost four Empire State Buildings. Curiously, due to the features of the internal structure, the VAB is in fact a one-story building. A 160 meter one-story building, the tallest in the world by this parameter. The building consists, in addition to the main huge structure, also of a slightly smaller annex, only 64 meters high. This is the height of a 20-story building. The extension plays the role of a small-sized assembly site, where parts of the rockets are brought in and begin their integration when the assembly is not too large. There are four bays allocated for this work. Immediately after the volume of the low hangar, there's the main volume of the high one. Here the picture is similar, but while the small hangar is large, the main one is simply enormous. It is similar in design. In the center is a giant empty space from floor to ceiling. On the sides of the center, surrounded by giant metal structures, there are four high bays, in which the final assembly of the rockets is being carried out, until they are ready for launch. These bays are pretty big, considering that the 110 meter Saturn V on top of a mobile platform could fit here easily. For lifting and moving parts of ships and rockets, a whole bunch of various cranes, including real giants, are located inside the complex. There are five large cranes under the ceiling. The first crane in the entrance hangar can lift 175 tons. Two more cranes, lifting 250 tons each, share work in the high bays. And finally, the main overhead crane can lift as much as 325 tons of cargo. Just so you understand, such an indicator means that the main crane can lift a fully fueled and equipped Boeing 777. So the 78-ton shuttle orbiter was a simple load for them, except that they had to be careful with the wing not to hit anything. Each of the four bays is equipped with its own gate for transporting the finished carrier outside. Well, not quite a gate. In fact, it is divided into seven vertically rising and four horizontally sliding sections of 139 meters high wall, the largest gate in the world. It takes 45 minutes to open and close such a wall. Moreover, each section of these gates can be controlled individually. Later, one of the gates was even widened by 12 meters to accommodate shuttles more conveniently. The winged spacecraft with side boosters was lower, but wider than the Saturn rockets. Meanwhile, the building is so huge that inside it, with the gates closed, its own weather is formed, right up to the appearance of clouds under the roof. To ensure the required temperature and humidity, the complex is equipped with a sophisticated air conditioning system, including 125 fans on the roof of the building, as well as four large air cooling units. And even this sometimes is not enough, so NASA engineers use a super innovative aerodynamic effect. A draft. Yes, given that the hangar has huge gates on all sides, it is sometimes easier to open the doors and ventilate the place. The VAB allows the assembly of four space vehicles in parallel. The assembly of rockets and ships begins several months before the scheduled launch date. The stages are delivered to the Space Center by various routes and end up in one of four bays. The base is a mobile launcher platform, MLP, a giant crawler transporter equipped with supports and a 137-meter launch umbilical tower. Each dock has its own exit and road, along which the MLP, after completion of assembly, takes the rocket out of the hangar and delivers it to one of the launch sites located a few kilometers to the east, on the coast. Slowly, the speed of movement is only about a mile per hour. There is no racing with such a load. Initially, there were also four launch sites planned, but already at the stage of the Apollo program implementation, it became clear that the launch frequency would not be so high. So, two sites were built, LC-39A and LC-39B. Although now, with the beginning of a new era of space conquest, they may add more launch sites. One of the brightest symbols of the building is the American flag, painted on one of its outer walls. With such a huge canvas, the artists were not shy and painted the largest flag in the world at that time, 63.7 meters high and 33.5 meters wide. Just the blue part with stars was the size of a basketball field. Later, on the adjacent wall on the other side of the gate, the equally huge NASA meatball insignia was painted. Of course, the VAB story wasn't finished with the end of the Apollo program. Having such a huge facility, NASA uses it in all of its programs involving large rockets. After the Saturns, the site was seriously modified, and the space shuttles were assembled here, connecting the orbiter with a large fuel tank and side boosters. Now the complex is being modernized again, already within the framework of the Artemis program, and the first SLS rocket, comparable in size and weight to the Saturn V, is being assembled here. Assembly is already underway, and the first launch is scheduled for early 2022. Despite all the constructive solutions, nature cannot be easily overcome. In 2004, Hurricane Francis hit Cape Canaveral and caused much destruction throughout the region. And as a dessert, a few weeks later, Hurricane Jean also swooped in, adding more damage. It is worth paying tribute to the builders. The VAB and other facilities bravely withstood the blow of the elements, although repairs were nevertheless required. The wind tore off some of the metal wall panels, and many extra windows appeared in the building. Florida is a wonderful place and great for a spaceport, but the weather can be difficult here. Everything has its own price. In the period from 2011 to 2014, after the shutdown of the Space Shuttle program, the building was actually idle, and tours were conducted here. But with the deployment of the new space program, a large-scale renovation began there, and now it is not easy to get in. This also applies to the rest of the infrastructure. Launch Pad 39B, the northern one, is being prepared for the SLS rocket. Site 39A is actively used by SpaceX now to launch Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy rockets. And later, other heavy rockets may appear there, so the spaceport will soon become an even more interesting place. The history of the giant hangar began long ago and will continue for a very long time. I think we will come back here later. Like and subscribe to the channel so as not to miss new stories. There's still a lot of interesting things on the horizon.